I'm Berks County Commissioner Christian Leinbach. I want to welcome you to our commissioners meeting for December the 9th. We are broadcasting live on Microsoft Teams live event, also on BCTV, as well as Facebook and YouTube Live. At this time, I'd like to recognize my executive assistant, Anne-Marie Grill.
Thank you, Commissioner. Public comment will be accepted in person and through the Q&A function. Please include your first name, last name, and municipality for all comments. Any comments without name and municipality will not be considered. Each citizen can submit one comment. Comment length is dictated by limitations of the platform being used, Teams Q&A, Facebook, and YouTube. In-person comments will be accepted first, followed by comments submitted virtually. The meeting comment period is limited to a total of 30 minutes, including both in-person and virtual comments. This time period may be extended at the discretion of the board. Please be concise. Comments that are germane to county business will be read during the meeting and should not be considered to be an interactive dialogue with the commissioners. The county solicitor shall be the final arbitrator of whether a comment is germane and should be read. Any commissioner response to public comment will be done at the discretion of the commissioners.
Thank you very much, Anne-Marie. At this time, we'll begin our meeting with a moment of silence, followed by a pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. The first item on our agenda is the Berks County Holiday Door Contest, and I want to recognize my colleague, Commissioner Kevin Barnhart.
Thank you, Commissioner Leinbach. And to our viewing audience, I just want to announce that for many years, the county has done decorating contests throughout our various departments in the County of Berks. We generally have a tree decorating contest, a door decorating contest, and a wreath. And we award prizes to those participating departments. And it really builds a spirit of cooperation and teamwork here. And especially during the pandemic, it really has created that sort of an excitement. And I guess it falls upon me, since I'm chair of the election board, to announce the results. They have been unaudited, so they still have to go through a process. But most, if not all, the folks who are on the 13th floor are the judges. So if you have any concern about the placement of your door, you can probably criticize one of the commissioners or Ron or our assistants, because we took a lot of time in looking at these. Jesse, my assistant, took the photographs, so we're scrolling those through the screen now. So everyone who did not have the opportunity to see all 15 contestants, they were spread amongst the services center, the courthouse, and the North Campus. And I'll just go through them rather quickly. MDJ Robinson, the Prothonotary's Office, Sheriff's Department, Judge Nevius's Chambers, Court Reporters, Election Services, Register of Wills, District Attorney, Human Resources Department, Juvenile Probation Office, the Controller's Office, Planning Department, Children's Alliance Center, Berksheim Business Office, and the Library System. And without further ado, since you've seen the pictures being scrolled through, our fourth place winner is the Children's Alliance Center. I don't know if we can scroll and look at. There we go. Oh, just went past it. There you go. Third place is Juvenile Probation Office. And well, you can clap if you want. It's okay. Second place is the Sheriff's Department. I do love the little door there, by the way. And first place is Election Services. So we will be distributing the gift cards to each of the departments throughout the day. And we really do appreciate all the 15 contestants. They did a tremendous job, again, pulling together all sorts of great ideas, some connected with a theme for the holiday and some connected with a theme that tied into their department. So it was really a great effort, and we do appreciate everyone pulling together as a Berks County team to make this happen. So I think it makes the employees happy as well as those who visit your departments. Gives them a little smile on their face to see the creativity we have here in Berks County as our great staff. So there you go.
Thank you very much, Commissioner. I want to give special recognition to Jesse Blauser. Jesse really led this effort. These things don't happen by accident. And I also want to thank every single department that participated. I will tell you, I did this right before I went to Atlanta for my NACO board meeting, and it was a blast. Looking at all the different ideas, how people try to incorporate what their department does into the theme. It was great for me. It helped kick off the holiday season. So thank you very much.
Yeah, I also want to thank everyone. It was great being able to go see all the doors. One thing I am waiting for is for the election results from the polling that was done down at the election store. So want to see.
I heard it's been delayed. Wrong date or something.
It's good when you can laugh. So
yes,
very good. Thank you, everyone. Much appreciated. Keep up the good work.
Don't you know you have to stay for the rest of the meeting? At this time, I'd like to recognize our Berks County Director of the Department of Emergency Services, Brian Gottschall, for the weekly Berks County COVID-19 data report, as well as the biweekly Coe County wellness update. Brian Gottschall.
Good morning, commissioners. I'm glad we were able to start out with something kind of pleasant and holiday-like, because our weekly report certainly does not fall into that category. Taking a look at our cases and testing, we continue to see a steady upward rise in cases in our community. A significant amount of positivity among our testing that is being done, representing a lot of COVID spreading again within Berks County. And this is the case throughout Pennsylvania, and as this slide shows, throughout the nation. Just a couple weeks ago, we were kind of jealously looking at Chester County and Philadelphia County, who appeared to be peaking out of their Delta surge. And they had actually dropped down from high to substantial case transmission. And we were kind of hoping that perhaps we would be headed in that direction soon, giving us the option to not have to mask in conformance with CDC guidelines. What we now see is that much of the gains throughout the nation that happened over the last number of weeks are now reversing. You can see that in all of the categories below low, counties have moved into worse conditions. In essence, that each of those categories has had a reduction in the number of counties nationwide, while the high transmission rate has had a significant growth in the last 7 days. Our pediatric cases in the 5 to 18-year-old group continue to bounce up and down, but as such remain relatively flat in a long-term trend. We are seeing continuous slow growth over the last number of weeks in our 0 to 4 category of ages, though. Things continue to look progressively worse for our hospitals. If we would just go back to the middle of November, we were looking at about 50% of these numbers in our Berks County hospitals. We continue to see the largest percentage of those involved in hospital interactions, both as far as general admissions, as well as in ICU and ventilator cases, being those who are in the unvaccinated categories, though. Continuous slow climb in our COVID deaths. This has been a theme now for months, where we don't see the nice flat slope that we had seen back through the summer months. We are just seeing a continuous slow climb week after week. Vaccination numbers, really not a whole lot to report about. Continued slow development in both our fully vaccinated as well as our one, our at least one dose. We again can't look at our corrected numbers for one dosers due to the data correction that CDC did a couple of weeks ago. It's going to take about 4 or 5 weeks of data until that kind of flattens itself out and we can begin to work those numbers back into the equation. At our Berks County Cares Clinic, we, as we mentioned previously, were closed for the holiday week, but were open last week and saw the largest usage of the clinic in that last week with 359 doses given during the hours that they were in operation. There is capacity there, and we would continue to encourage people to utilize Penn State's registration system, which is available as a link through from doyourpartberks.com to register for vaccine there or at any one of the providers throughout the county. One interesting change that we're seeing is for many, many weeks, in fact, months, we have been leading Pennsylvania's growth in vaccinations in almost all age groups. In essence, that in Berks County, we were seeing our vaccine growth since the end of March outpacing the growth in Pennsylvania as a whole. That trend is starting to reverse itself, and Pennsylvania, on average, is now beginning to outpace Berks County as far as that new growth or new folks pursuing vaccines since the end of May. As we've done for a number of weeks, we want to keep an eye on influenza. The red line with the circled data points in the lower left-hand part of the graph represents this year's influenza growth, and then each of the colored lines representing other years in the last decade. And what we can see here is that in Berks County, in Pennsylvania, we're seeing influenza growing at a rate that is greater than what we had seen it grow in any of those other prior years. A reminder to folks that in 2020 into 21, the first year where we had an overlap of COVID and influenza, we were very much protected from influenza. That's the yellow line on the bottom of the graph that is very flat all across by our COVID mitigation measures. As we've seen the public not adopting those mitigation measures with the same level of aggressiveness this year, we're likewise not seeing that protection from influenza, and we're seeing our influenza numbers grow at a very concerning rate. While the slope is very steep, and the rise off of the zero line is much earlier than in many years, in all of the years in the last decade, I do want to point out that we still do have kind of exit ramps for these numbers. We have the opportunity to correct this, to flatten that curve, and, you know, hopefully make it look more like a 2015, 2016 year, the light green, where we only got up to this 4,000 cases in that week. This is all within the public's control to make those types of changes if they would choose to. Not a whole lot new to say on our vaccine recommendations, and assuming CDC doesn't make any changes over the next week, we'll begin to back these slides out of our weekly report, not waste time with them because they have now stabilized as far as what the vaccine recommendations are for the age groups and how boosters are to be handled for the various categories of folks now. Getting into our current events and things on the horizon, we mentioned last week that the FDA advisory panel had recommended approval of the Merck oral antiviral, and we thought that there would be a decision from FDA one way or the other very quickly on that. That has not been the case, and we are still waiting for an FDA decision on that oral antiviral. Likewise, we're waiting for Pfizer to submit its final data to FDA to begin the process of potential approval for its oral antiviral. So as it stands today, our infused or subcutaneously injected monoclonal antibodies are really the treatments that are out there. This hoped for home solution for antivirals is not yet something that's on the table for usage. This is a lot going on this slide, but it's also a lot of the interest right now in COVID, and that is the COVID variant that has been deemed has been determined to be called Omicron. We're now starting to see lab data come in primarily from South Africa and other locations where it was more prevalent and earlier. There's really some good news and some bad news in this. And I'm going to tick through it a little bit with some narrative. On the good news front, we see that this variant is using the same what are called ACE2 receptors, the binding points on our cells where the virus connects to. And this is kind of a key and lock kind of thing. If our cells had binding points that looked like triangles, but the virus had binding points that looked like squares, they wouldn't match up and the virus wouldn't be very good at getting into our cells. So one of the ways that we address diseases, and this is not just COVID, but viruses in general, is by making vaccines that tie up those binding points so they can't get in. But that means that the vaccines have to have binding points that look like whatever version of the virus they were developed to address. And the good news is that the binding points of the Omicron variant look similar to the binding points of prior variants. And therefore, the belief is that our vaccines will be reasonably good at binding up to those same points and doing their job. On the bad news front, it appears as though the Omicron has binding points that are more aggressively able to get into cells when there is not protection there. And as we look at vaccine efficacy through the use of what are called convalescent plasma studies, where they basically take the plasma, the blood of people who have developed immunity to some extent to COVID through either vaccine or prior infection, and they bind and they mix that with this new variant to understand how things are going to work out, we're seeing a significant reduction in the neutralizing antibodies effectiveness as compared to what was there against Delta. And while that's bad, the good news is that it's not as bad as was originally expected. So when we were first understanding about Omicron, there was a great deal of concern. And while that concern appears to have been founded, it is not as bad as we thought it might have been with respect to the development of neutralizing antibodies against this particular variant. And in fact, when a booster is involved here, or when prior infection is involved here along with vaccination, there is a significantly better outcome than that 40-fold reduction. And the hope is that that reflects what a boosted response might look like. And all of this that was determined by the Africa Health Research Institute is supported by Pfizer's own internal findings about the efficacy of their vaccine. We still have to find more out about the other vaccines that are out there. And we also want to have an eye to another study that was done by the University Hospital of Frankfurt. This was reported on by the virologist that led that study, Sandra Cizak, through her Twitter page. In that case, the findings were actually significantly less desirable than what was found in the AHRI study. So it's important to understand that all of these studies are still what are considered pre-publication. They were not yet peer-reviewed and formally released, but we're trying to look at the information that's available out there as early as possible, give it the credence that it's due, but understand that it is pre-publication. The last thing I want to mention on the good news front is that we have to remember that while all of this vaccine stuff is very important, while neutralizing antibodies are critical in the fight against COVID, we have other means in our immune systems to help protect us against the virus. And those other means are our B cell machines, our killer T cells, as they're called, are also things that we have to consider in how our bodies are going to be able to respond to Omicron. Much to be written about this yet, but we want to get the information out there as early as we can. So we also want to look at like how things might be different in South Africa compared to how they might be in the US. And of course, in the US, we have a much higher vaccination rate. We are also still in a significant Delta surge. If you look at the South Africa data, their Delta surge had peaked back in early July, and they were very much on a downswing and in a bottom valley of COVID transmissibility in their country. We, of course, are still very much in a Delta surge. And the hope was that our high vaccination rate, as well as the fact that we have a lot of resistance that's in the community due to the prevalence of Delta in people today, were going to help to harden us against Omicron. And the unfortunate fact is that as we look at information coming out of the UK, which much more looks like us than South Africa looks like us, that is not playing out to the extent that we had hoped. So again, the kind of good news, bad news side of things that we want to talk about here. It's very difficult to look at hospitalization data from other countries and transmit that or compare that to the United States because of significant differences in our hospital systems. And we also don't know very much about what long COVID will look like with Omicron. Is it more likely to create long COVID or less likely to create long COVID than original COVID or Delta or Beta to a lesser extent, which are the variants that we've dealt with here in the United States? And there, of course, will be weeks until we understand what the death outcomes are from Omicron and can understand that mortality data. So we're going to try to continue to give the best, most available information that we have and also clearly explain the sources of that data so that people understand in some cases that it needs to be taken with somewhat of a grain of salt. We want to remind everyone that we have public COVID drive-up testing here outside of our offices at 2561 Burnville Road. That testing is continuing to be offered as planned and the dates and times shown. And we also want to mention, as the Reading Eagle helped us to make known to the public, that we've been able to extend that testing to now include dates going out from 12/14 through 12/22 at the dates and times indicated. You don't have to worry about writing all of this down. DoYourPartBerks.com has all of this information available to you anytime you want to go look it up. Just a reminder that the best access to get into that testing is from 183 onto Van Reed Road and then turning into the parking lot, as the red arrow indicates. There are signs posted locally to help you kind of get directed once you get in the area here near the building. Want to take a look at our Coe County wellness numbers, as we do every 2 weeks. What we see here is that their workload is going up dramatically. You can see that the sum of all of these numbers representing what they've done in the last 2 weeks is significantly higher than the sums in the 2 week periods prior. So they're getting a lot more case investigations coming to them. However, based on the size of the bars and how they compare in a 2 week period, you know, red to red, orange to orange, green to green, what you see is that we're really not seeing any improved effort by the public to help cooperate and work with them as these case investigations are being done. The percentages of successful contacts and ultimately of case investigation questionnaires returned is remaining very much the same, even though Coe County is doing a lot more work because a lot more cases are there to be investigated. Likewise, in contact tracing, we're seeing very similar public response, despite the fact that there are more contacts being worked based on our increased case numbers in the community. So we have to take this opportunity to again encourage the public to please work with our public health partners who are trying to do case investigations and contact tracing to let other folks who may be exposed to the disease know that they've been exposed so that they can make the decision to take the right steps and quarantine themselves until they're tested and cleared as far as their potential for being further vectors of the spread of the disease.
And Brian, please note that confidentiality is a critical piece of this. If you could explain how that works, I think sometimes we take that for granted that people understand that.
Absolutely. The folks that are doing these investigations are professionals. They understand the need for confidentiality. They've got a great deal of experience and history in doing contact tracing and case investigations, primarily for sexually transmitted diseases prior to the COVID engagement, but these folks are not sharing your information with anyone. No one here at the county, you know, we get this type of data that's de-identified. We don't know anybody's personal information. That's a matter of confidence among the involved parties, the Department of Health and Coe County Wellness, who's providing these services. So folks can feel free to share, understanding that their data is being protected and no names or demographics that could tie back to a name are being shared with anyone. Thanks for bringing that up, Commissioner. So the last thing we want to talk about in the current events is, and I saved this slide at the end because I really wanted to wrap up the presentation with it because it is so important, so current. We've been talking since the spring of 2020 when we first understood COVID about healthcare impacts and the risks of overwhelming our hospitals. And I think that we need to qualify this by saying overwhelming means different things to different people. So some people might think that our healthcare system is overwhelmed if they have to wait an hour in the ER, and other people may not think it's overwhelmed until there are individuals laying on, you know, leaf mats on the sidewalk outside of the hospitals. I would say that the real truth is probably somewhere in between, and this is what we want to convey to the public, that we are no longer in a hypothetical of what if our healthcare system is overwhelmed. It is overwhelmed now. And this is as much about people as it is about beds. We need to care for the people who are providing these services in our hospitals and healthcare institutions. And the reality is that they are beat up. When you talk to these people, there's not a lot there behind the eyes. You know, they have seen it all, they've done it all, and they need a break. And there's nothing that can be done by our local governments. There's nothing that can be done by our local hospitals to give them a break. The public now needs to step up and recognize that we are in a position that we really need to begin caring for our healthcare institutions as critical community resources now, or else we're going to get to a point beyond where we are now, where the public is going to start to feel the outcome of those impacts even beyond the level that they already are, which is right now in long waiting times to be able to get non-acute care. We don't want anyone to fail to use the healthcare system when they need it. God forbid we have someone sitting at home with chest pain who says, well, I'm not going to call an ambulance because I heard that guy talk about how busy they are and I don't want to be part of the problem. That's the other extreme of the issue. We don't want people to avoid calling for EMS, going to the hospital when they have true, potentially life-threatening medical emergencies. But what we do want people to do is stop using the EMS system and the ERs in place of having a family physician when they have a minor ache and pain, when they need to get some a medicine refilled or those types of things. This is going on right now, and we need folks to understand that ambulances are not going to get you care faster. Your condition is going to do that. Whether you go to the hospital on foot, by taxi cab, in your own vehicle, or in an ambulance, you're not going to get seen any faster because you come into the ED in an ambulance. You're going to get seen at the ED based on the condition you are presenting with. And if you go there in an ambulance and you didn't need to, and the condition you're presenting with does not speak to the need for immediate care, you're going to get taken right out to the front of the waiting room, no different than somebody who walked in off the street is going to get sent to the front of the waiting room. So, number one, we need the public to begin using the healthcare system more responsibly, making good choices between using the emergency room, going to an urgent care facility, or going to your primary care physician or a walk-in type clinic. The other thing we need the public to do is to get very serious about tamping down both COVID and influenza. We understand that these are personal decisions, and we're not going to be able to convince people who have made up their mind about things like vaccine, about things like masking, about things like social distancing, to make up their minds. But for those of you that are on the fence, or those of you that are attempting to care for your fellow citizens and our healthcare systems, we would say that now's the time to buckle down. Do what you can that you will when you can. If you're not going to be 100%, you know, maybe you're opposed to vaccines, but you're willing to mask, or you're willing to implement other mitigation measures that we've talked about now for the last 20 months. Now is the time to do it, because we're seeing healthcare impacts beyond those that we've not seen in the past. For the first time in my career, we had both of our Berks County hospitals on ER divert, basically running the flag up the pole and saying, if there's the ability to take patients to other hospitals, do so, because we cannot take them here in the fashion that we would like to take them and care for them. This is huge. This means that people are being asked to go to emergency rooms in other counties. What actually put our emergency rooms over the top over the tipping point the other night is the fact that in a 1 hour period, we had 10 patients coming in from other counties that were diverted from other hospitals. So this is not a Berks problem. It is a healthcare problem. It is a broad community problem. And we need to emphasize to the public that the solution to this problem rests with every man, woman, and child doing the right thing so that we can better protect our healthcare institutions and our caregivers in those institutions from the incredible volume that they're seeing that is on an upward, not a plateau, not a downward trend, but an upward trend right now. So I hope that wasn't too preachy, commissioners, but we really do need the public's help with this. And as always, we direct the public to doyourpartberks.com to find resources about COVID vaccine, and about COVID testing. If there are no other questions or comments, back to you.
Thank you very much, Brian. That is certainly a sobering report. And hopefully our public and Berks County residents will take it to heart. Are there any additions or corrections for the December 2nd commissioner meeting minutes? Hearing none, the minutes will stand approved as presented. We did have an executive session yesterday, December the 8th, dealing with personnel and contract negotiations. I see there's no public here in person, and I don't believe there's any public comment online either. So we will move into the agenda. Item one, authorizing under that budget department, adopt a resolution authorizing 2021 budget transfers in the amount of $27,881 and 2021 appropriations in the amount of $337,000. $951 per listing dated December 3rd. Several items under human resources. Item one, authorize the appointment of Tracy Shoemaker to judicial administrative assistant in court administration. Item two, authorize the transfer of Valerie Baldwin from office support two to judicial coordinator in court administration. Item three, authorize a salary adjustment for Brenda Hine, fiscal officer in the Sheriff's Department. Item four, authorize Troy Wolf, Sergeant, Sheriff's Department, to work out of classification in the captain position. Item five, authorize salary adjustments for judicial coordinators in court administration. Item six, authorize salary adjustments for judicial administrative assistants in court administration. Purchasing, adopt a resolution authorizing the award and the Director of Contracts and Procurements to execute four contracts with three-year term at the rate of $21 per hour for personal care and home support services as a result of a request for proposal for in-home personal care and home support services for the County of Berks Area Agency on Aging. It's as follows, Caregivers America out of Clark Summit, PA. I Am Home Care out of Reading, PA. Open System Healthcare out of Philadelphia. And Romar Corporation out of Reading, PA. Okay, I asked for the wrong amounts for budget assumptions. It was updated and the number should be $856,034. Right. Yep, sorry about that. Several items listed under myself. Item A, adopt a resolution authorizing the reappointment of David Phillips, Mooresville, PA, to serve as the chair of the Berks County Agricultural Land Preservation Board for a one-year term to expire December 31st of 2022. Item B, adopt a resolution authorizing the appointment of Amy Sundstrom, Pottstown, Pennsylvania, to the Berks County Children and Youth Services Advisory Board for a three-year term expiring on December 31st of 2024. Item C, adopt a resolution authorizing the appointment of Amy Pletz, Burnville, Pennsylvania, to the Berks County Children and Youth Services Advisory Board for a three-year term expiring on December 31st of 2024. And item D, adopt a resolution authorizing the appointment of Dave Klein, Sinking Spring, Pennsylvania, to the Berks County Park and Rec Board for a four-year term expiring on December 31st of 2025. Several items listed under Commissioner Rivera. Item A, adopt a resolution authorizing the appointment of Jenna M. Maritorana. Maritorana. Why missing PA to the Berks County MHDD Advisory Board for a three-year term expiring December 31st of 2024. Item B, adopt a resolution authorizing the appointment of Jamie Perez, Sinking Spring, Pennsylvania, to the Berks County Housing Authority for a five-year term expiring on December 31st of 2026. Item C, adopt a resolution authorizing the appointment of Michael Toledo, Reading, PA, to the Berks County Children and Youth Services Advisory Board for a three-year term expiring on December 31st of 2024. Commissioners, item A, adopt a resolution authorizing the chair to execute a memorandum of understanding by and between the Berks Alliance and the County of Berks, agreed on engaging Lit Communications to provide broadband consulting services and perform a feasibility study to analyze current needs for additional broadband services within Berks County, Pennsylvania. Item B, adopt a resolution authorizing the chair to execute the Pittsburgh Business Group on Health Employer Member Application for 2022 for participation in the Prescription Drug Consortium. Item C, adopt a resolution authorizing the chair to execute the following 2022-2023 P-Corp renewal documents. Item one, general instructions. Item two, P-Corp renewal payment options commission selection. Item D, adopt a resolution authorizing the chair to execute the Home Investment Partnership American Rescue Plan program applications and agreements for additional funding in the amount of $2,296,766, which will require amendments or budget revisions to its fiscal year 2021 annual action plan. We have Ken Pick on the phone, and I'm going to ask Ken Pick to briefly explain this item. Ken?
Thank you, Commissioner Barnhart and Rivera and Linebach, and good morning to everyone else. The American Rescue Plan provided funds to the U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development to create a special version of the Home Investment Partnerships Program. The county will receive $2,296,766, which has to be spent, by the way, by September 30th of 2030. Now, the special version of the home program is directed to qualifying populations. So every project that we fund has to be directed to homeless, people are at risk of homelessness, domestic violence, dating violence, sexual assault, human trafficking, or other populations that need social services. And the uses are affordable rental housing, non-congregate sheltering, tenant-based rental assistance, and social services, operating expenses, and administration. I think it was fortunate in Berks that we had projects either on the books that needed funding or projects on the books that required additional funding that meet all the requirements of this special program. And what you see in the resolution is funds for administration, funds for the homeless veterans project on Walnut Street, another house for non-congregate sheltering for Family Promise, and then a project with Opportunity House for some additional affordable rental housing for homeless. Again, I think it was fortunate that we had projects in the pipeline or the needed funding for the use of these funds. Again, the county will receive $2,296,766 from the special allocation of funds to for the Home Investment Partnership Program. That's kind of a quick overview. I'd be willing to take questions if there are any, or answer or anything else that the commissioners would like me to speak to about the program.
Comments? Thank you very much, Ken. Item two, a motion to authorize execution of contract agreements and amendments as set forth on the attached listing dated December 6th of 2021. There are five contracts, one with Children and Youth Services, one with the commissioners, one with court administration, one with facilities and operations, and one with the print shop. And then item three, a motion to authorize execution of the payments and electronic transfers as set forth on the Controller's Office voucher listing dated December the 9th of 2021.
Motion to approve the agenda as presented.
Second.
Motion has been made and seconded. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? The motion is carried. We'll turn now to our County Treasurer, Dennis Adams, with the Treasurer's Report. Dennis.
Yes. I had to find my unmute button. Good morning. Yeah, I've had just a little bit of problems getting out here to hear you guys this morning, but it got worked out in a hurry. So anyways, the opening balance today was $167,826,849.38, a balance to clear of $3,410,275.75, and a balance today then of $164,416,573.63.
Thank you very much, Dennis. And now we'll turn to our County Controller, Sandy Graffius, with the Controller's Report.
Good morning, gentlemen. Total accounts payable, $7,249,456.78. We had a payroll, $4,393,899.12. For total disbursements of $11,643,355.90.
Thank you very much, Sandy. We'll move now to our Chief Administrative Officer, Ron Seaman.
Thank you, Commissioner Linebach. Continuing on with the schedule of events in conjunction with the annual holiday lights display at Grings Mill, this weekend, again, the display is available between the hours of 6 and 9 p.m. In addition to the fire pit model train display, there is also musical entertainment and food and beverages available from food trucks for Friday, December the 10th. The entertainment will be provided by Mount Laurel Brass. There'll be a strolling Belschnickel, and the food will be provided by Which Way Sandwiches. December the 11th, Dave Klein will present a Mountain Folk Christmas. There'll be a strolling Santa, and the food will be provided by the Caboose Crew. And then on Sunday, December the 12th, Wendy Thompson Harpist will be performing, and the food will be provided by Mad J's Barbecue. Again, come on out, have a nice evening with your family, and enjoy the light display. If anyone needs more information, please see countyofberks.com/parks. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ron. Turn now to Commissioner Michael Rivera.
Thank you, Commissioner Linebach. I just want to reiterate something I mentioned, I think it was a week or two ago. Just for those who are looking to rent or looking to do a rent to own, please be very careful. It's just, there was an article this week in NBC of a similar situation that is going on in Detroit and how prevalent it is there. So please, if you're looking to rent or to do rent to own, make sure that you verify who you're actually contracting with, that it is the owner of the property. Don't want to pay for years at home and then find that you don't own it, and you don't want to either find out that you gave someone money for rent deposit and rent and they don't own the home and you'll never be able to move into it. So just want to make people aware of that. And if you know of anyone, especially the elderly, if they tell you they're looking to rent, try to help and guide them along to make sure that they're not scammed through this process. That's all I have.
Thank you very much, Commissioner Rivera. Two items. First of all, I want to highlight that our commissioners meeting next week, that's December the 16th, will begin at 7 p.m. and will be available through Microsoft Teams, VCTV, Facebook, and YouTube Live, but we will be located at the Muhlenberg Township building in Muhlenberg. So people that want to come out physically, that's where you'll need to go. It will not be here in the morning at 10 o'clock. It will be there 7 p.m. in the evening. Next week is when we will be voting on the final budget for 2022. So it's an important meeting. I just want to touch on my meetings last week in Atlanta with the National Association of Counties. I always like to bring back some information from those conferences. This was primarily a board meeting, but I was also involved in several workshops. A couple of items I want to share. One, I sat in a session on economic development, and I thought this was an interesting discussion because often we interchange economic development and economic growth. Here's what I wrote down. Economic development and economic growth are not the same thing. Development is about capacity that may lead to growth. Economic development can be people, buildings, infrastructure, etc. Growth is the realized potential of economic development. The reason that's important, we need to understand that just because we build things that are called economic development, or we invest in workforce training, or in any number of areas, doesn't mean that that's automatically going to boost our economy. We have to do our homework up front and understand what are the risks and opportunities in any type of investment in economic development. I thought it was a really powerful session. We also discussed a bill, and I've actually followed up on this since. It is House Bill 5735 that simplifies the American Rescue Plan lost revenue formula. If anyone in our county government that's been involved in figuring out that formula, it is confusing. As recently as I think yesterday, was it you, Ron? I think I was on with Ron. Ron gave me the latest number, and I'm not going to go through it, but I've had numbers all over the place because the process in figuring out lost revenue is very, very complicated. Congressman Dan Muser is a prime sponsor of this bill, happens to represent part of Berks County. I've been in contact with him. NACO strongly supports this. It basically would allow every county to automatically claim a minimum of $10 million as lost revenue. Now, before people ask the question, well, what if a county only received $5 million in ARP money? And while we received $81.6 million, keep in mind, we have a population of 429,000 people. There are counties in this country that have populations of 10,000, 15,000, 20,000. I think there's a county with right around 3,000 people. They're going to get less than 10 million. For them, it would mean they could take their entire ARP money and count it as lost revenue. So that's a piece of legislation we're watching very closely and supporting strongly. I'm not going to go into anything else at this juncture, but those were two of the takeaways that I brought back from our board meeting in Atlanta, Georgia. That is all that I have. Are there any comments from any of our row officers? Hearing none, are there any public comments? And there are not. Anything else for the good of the order?
Motion to adjourn.
The meeting is adjourned.